I've been greatly encouraged, first of all, over the last few days, to find out that Americans are paying attention. They realize what's at risk. They realize there's a great deal at stake in this country. And now, maybe not more than ever, but as much as ever, we need to be about the business of getting this country on track. And I've mentioned before, Mr. Speaker, but in recent years, I guess maybe three or so ago, my wife and I had gone to Togo in West Africa, right by Nigeria, and Mercy Ships, headquartered in my district, is just an awesome charitable institution. They bring a huge medical hospital, really, ship into a dock, into a third world country, usually in Africa. And it's controlled by Christians. It's operated by Christians. They don't proselytize, but they do the job of reaching out, ministering. After the ship's been there, blind can see, lame can walk, people with massive tumors that were about to have their breathing cut off by the massive tumor are able to live. Women who had a child and developed a small hole in either the urinary tract or the colon when having a child that had been banned from family, sometimes 20 years, they were not allowed to be with the family. They were considered unclean, would have the fistula repaired, and for the first time, after rather emotional ceremonies, they would be reunited with family members. Sometimes, like I say, they hadn't seen in 20 years, specific occasions like that. And it's an amazing thing to watch, and was there for a week. Really was blessed to help out with a number of different things. But some of the West Africans wanted to meet with me before I left. They knew I was in Congress. Some of them are a little perplexed to see a member of Congress. They were told he was a member of Congress, but he's back there washing dishes in the kitchen. But my late mother once said, "I'm not going to have you bunch of boys grow up and not be able to cook and wash dishes." So she made sure we could, and we can. But we had the meeting with the West Africans there. They were Christians. And the oldest senior citizen, hardworking man, after we had a really nice visit, he concluded, in essence, by saying, "We were so thrilled when you first black president," his words. But since then, we've seen America getting weaker. It appears you're getting weaker and weaker. And the weaker it appears America gets, the more we suffer. Please go back to Washington and tell your friends there, stop getting weaker, because we know where we go when we die, but our only chance of having peace in this world is if America is strong. Don't try to shove my religious beliefs on others, but it's a part of who I am, just as it was with most of our founding fathers and those that went before us. But we were founded on Judeo-Christian beliefs. If you go look at one of the most important documents that established our independence, yes, the Declaration of Independence is critical. We're endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights. But the Treaty of Paris, 1783, that was after the Revolutionary War. After the war had been won, But the Americans weren't sure that Britain wasn't going to come back. They had the most powerful navy, the most powerful army. What's to say they wouldn't come back? And so it was critical that a document be signed and something put in that document that was so important, that would be such an oath, that the leaders of Great Britain would not dare break that oath, that they truly would recognize the United States as being independent and free of Great Britain. And I didn't know until I got to Congress. I mean, I read history books, I read biographies, I love to learn more all the time, but I was struck when our pastor David Dykes, his wife Cindy, were up here and they wanted to go on a tour of the State Department. I'd never been through a tour of the State Department, went with them, and lo and behold, there was an original copy of the Treaty of Paris, the actual treaty. We were told it was an original copy. And I was surprised at the huge, big, bold letters that started the document. Because that document, if that is not signed, we're not free and independent, regardless of what the Declaration of Independence says. It means Britain's going to come in anytime they get ready to. There had to be something so important put in that document so that when they signed it, they wouldn't dare want to break it. The words that started the Treaty of Paris, 1783, were, "In the name of the most holy and undivided Trinity." That's a Christian belief. That was so important and held with such reverence that neither side would want to break an oath under the name of the most holy and undivided Trinity. Mr. Speaker, for those that don't know, I know you do, but that means the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. That's how the Treaty of Paris started, that established not just our hopes and aspirations and principles, as the Declaration of Independence did. This was the treaty that gave us the independence. So, yeah, we got back into a fight with Great Britain in 1812, the War of 1812, 1814, part of that war. This building was burned, and apparently if it had not been for a massive thunderstorm or rainstorm that night, this would have gone the way. This actual wing didn't come into existence for about 40 years, 44 years or so. But the reason we didn't get a big ruin up here on what was once called Jenkins Hill was because the rainstorm put out the fire. The roof was badly damaged. But and even though sandstone, marble, granite doesn't burn necessarily, in the presence of extreme heat, you get cracks and it falls. We didn't get a big ruin because of the rainstorm. Some thought maybe we ought to move the Capitol back to Philadelphia or New York. But others felt that what was here was preserved for a reason. So it was built back. It's a part of our founding. And what we have seen in the last 6 years, as this noble effort by our president wanting to bring peace through the world by showing how nice we were, by showing that we meant them no harm, we would be glad to meet with them, to sit down, we'll give them offices, we'll give them things, we'll let murderers go from prison, and those type things will show our enemies how really decent and good we are. And so they'll want to be our friends and will not want to be at war with us. The only problem is that may work in some Common Core type thing taught in school, but it is not in touch with reality. Because there is evil in this world. And that evil has been most recently manifested repeatedly in radical Islamic jihadist actions. And there is no way around it. And the more the people in this administration refuse to rise up and call evil what it is, the more the evil rises up. Now, last June, I was asked to go to Nigeria and meet with 23 of the mothers of daughters who were kidnapped by Boko Haram, a radical Islamic group. And I hope and pray more around this town, especially down the end of Pennsylvania Avenue, will begin to develop the courage and understanding that we're not going to bring peace to Christians and Jews throughout the world, and we're not going to bring peace to moderate Muslims who want to stand up to radical Islamists, but they know they go to the top of the death chart. But we have got to have people in the executive branch understand this is evil, and it's done in the name of Islam, and it is radical, and it is what they believe is jihad. Yes, it is their religion. It's not the religion of moderate Muslims, but to them, it's their religion. It's their religion. It's their politics. It's their worldview. And under their worldview, you don't have freedom of expression. And ultimately, Sharia law will prevail, and either they must wipe you out and kill you as dogs, or some of the more moderate of the radicals will allow you to pay a tax, admit that you're subservient to the Islamists, and they may let you live in peace unless they feel that they're being led by some religious fanatic to do otherwise. Things around the world have gotten worse for Christians and Jews because we had an administration as noble and idealistic as it wanted to be, as wonderful as it would be if you could just say, we want to be at peace and we'll turn the other cheek. That is not for a government to do. Even a Christian-based government, as this one started, for most of this country's existence. For Christians, there is an obligation to follow the Beatitudes, the teachings of Christ. But, Mr. Speaker, some get confused and think that's the government's role. That if its people get killed, well, if we just say, oh, that was probably deserved it, then it will stop. It does not. It gets worse. People need to begin to understand what's going on in this world. There is evil, and people are being killed and tortured, and women and young girls raped, and their lives stolen from them, Christians and Jews being persecuted in greater numbers than any time in the world's existence. Not greater percentage, but greater numbers. And I met with many Nigerians who've been adversely affected by this radical Islamist, yes, radical Islamist group, Boko Haram. And make no mistake, I am not advocating for sending troops into Nigeria. That would be a huge mistake, in my opinion. But we can help them. They need intelligence. We might could use a drone and drop a bomb that might help save many Christians from the horrors they're experiencing. We could work with the southern, with part of the Nigerian government at least, to help save those people. And I mentioned before, I asked, these were all Christians, you know, did they attack this girls' school because I know they don't believe girls should be educated. And they said, no, they don't believe girls should be educated, but they attacked the school because they knew it was a Christian school. And usually when they attack a school, if there's boys, they kill the boys, and then they take the girls and sell them into sex slavery. And in the case of these innocent children, these girls, they took them captive. They raped them repeatedly. They abused them severely. They demanded that they convert from Christianity to Islam. But I asked the Christian pastor, and we were a couple hours outside of town where I had to go without State Department or other people that would not have wanted me to put myself in that situation. But getting out to the remote location, secret location where these survivors were, I said, where are the fathers, to the pastor? And he said, oh, that's another part of the tragedy. They know the girls are being raped, sexually abused, abused in so many ways. They left their homes and they went into the bush because they are the fathers. They were supposed to protect their children. And they feel guilty and they don't believe they deserve to be in a bed or a home while their daughters are being abused like they are. That's a real human tragedy. And then as we hear, not of just some violent action in Paris, France, it was a terrorist action committed by radical Islamic jihadists who are being taught, so many of them, as tiny children growing up to hate the West, to hate Western civilization, to hate America, that it's a good thing to kill innocent Americans, and that somehow in their weird religious belief in this evil, that they somehow benefit by killing and harming what are really innocent people. A story from CNS News, January 8th, Curtis Kellen. In the wake of the terrorist attack on the offices of French satirist paper Charlie Hebdo, one Muslim cleric justified the murders under Islamic law. And Mr. Speaker, for those that don't understand, when they say they're justifying this under Islamic law, it means to them it's their religion. Yes, it is their religion. USA Today published a column by a vowed radical Muslim cleric, Azim Choudhury. The piece titled People Know the Consequences asked why France would allow the paper to mock Islam and further excuse the systematic murders as justified under Islamic law. And then it quotes him, Muslims consider the honor of the Prophet Muhammad to be dearer to them than that of their own parents or even themselves. To defend it is considered to be an obligation upon them. The strict punishment, if found guilty of this crime under Sharia law, is capital punishment implemented by an Islamic state. This is because the Messenger Muhammad said, quote, whoever insults a prophet, kill him, unquote. See, now for those that don't understand, those are people that are saying, this is our religion, it's our state, it's our lives. And until the people leading this administration understand that, it's going to get worse. And I do believe what's in the Bible, that to whom much is given, of them much will be required. And we have been put here in America in such a place and time that if we stand strong, we don't have to send American troops who then end up being seen as occupiers, but we can help. We can give them intelligence. We can give them the ability, as we did in Africa for within about 4 or 5 months. We, with less than 500 American special ops people and intelligence, they defeated the Taliban by February 2002. And then we became occupiers, added tens of thousands of troops, ended up eventually with over 100,000 in this administration. And occupiers don't do well in that part of the world. And if we tried to be occupiers in Nigeria, we wouldn't do very well. But we can help with information if we get weapons in the right hand. And I'm not talking about sending weapons to the Free Syrian Army that is working frequently with the Islamic State. I'm talking about putting them in the hands of people that are our friends. Send them directly to those that we can be sure are our friends in Nigeria. Send them to Erbil, where I was 3 weeks ago, in northern Iraq with the Kurds. They didn't throw down their weapons. They didn't hand them over to the Islamic State. They stood and fought. They're still standing and fighting. They helped clear an avenue to free some people who were trapped on a mountain while I was there. And my dear friend Dana Rohrbacher set the trip up. He and I have traveled so many places. My friend Steve King was there. Gregory Meek was there, a good man. And we also were in Kabul in Afghanistan. There's hope there. But we have got to be smart about the way that we help. But it does not help when we can't even recognize the enemy. I warned about one of the Homeland Security advisors, top advisors, for a number of years. And finally, after all this time, and back, I believe it was in August, when he tweeted out with the Islamic State beheading and killing people, this advisor, top advisor in the Obama administration, tweeted out that, hey, you know, the Islamic caliphate is inevitable, so, you know, just relax. Words to that effect. And finally, that was enough. They let him resign and not renew his term again. Thank goodness. But today, and I've been talking with people in Nigeria, emailing, and have great hopes for girls I've met with, these young girls, that they're going to come out of it. They're still traumatized. The families are still traumatized. The girls have not been released, and it doesn't appear this administration has done anything to really help. As I was communicating with friends, African friends in Nigeria, we get word of this story. This one from NBC News. More than 2,000 people are unaccounted for after radical Islamic sect Boko Haram torched more than 10 towns and villages in Nigeria, a local lawmaker told NBC News. Ahmed Zana, a senator for Borno State where the attack happened, said the militants razed the town of Baga, as well as 10 to 20 other communities in the country's rural northeast over the past 5 days. These towns are just gone, burned down. The whole area is covered in bodies. Look, I know that there are people in this administration, including our president, that think you can win over evil by just being nice to it. offering to buy offices in Qatar, offering to release the evil forces murderers from captivity, and that such wonderful, gallant gestures will turn the tide. Well, individuals can, but governments are supposed to protect the people. And we in America, and it's causing this weakness and to grow, and with evil to grow around the world, there's a vacuum being filled as we have lost our leadership role around the world, and it's being filled with evil religious nastiness called radical Islam. And as this administration continues to act as if it's not a religion, and we can win them over with kindness, more people die. Now they're saying maybe 2,000 Nigerians have died today. So I couldn't help but reflect back to my senior citizen friend in Togo and his words, his imploring, stop getting weaker. When America gets weaker, we suffer. How much suffering is this administration going to allow before it wakes up to the reality of what radical Islam is? Until such time, this Congress needs to stand up and say, we're not going to keep supplying weapons to radical Islamists who are working with the Islamic State in Syria. We'll help our friends like the Kurds. We're not going to keep supplying weapons to people that may have them end up with the Taliban. We are going to help our friends like we did the Northern Alliance in Afghanistan. It's time to wake up to the reality of evil that is radical Islam is, because until this administration does, it's going to get worse. And with that, I yield back.